Yeah, thank you, Professor Mark LePaul, for this comprehensive and informative presentation. I think we have a few questions. We have more than 700 attendees for this presentation, so hopefully we could have some time for questions. So there's a question here from Dr. Adana Lisa. Thanks for a great talk. What do you think about the reliability of the serology testing? There are some patients with positive PCR and testing negative for serology.
Yeah.
Why some patients who are positive to COVID-19 and treated became negative and after exposure? So she's wondering about the reliability.
You know, let me answer the first question, then tell me the second part. Sure. We have probably more than 10 tests in the U.S. There's one that was developed at Mount Sinai. We think that it's accurate, but it's very clear that there are not only false negatives, there are false positives too. So the testing is not 100% reliable, but it's reasonably reliable. You know, I will say we also have patients who have antibodies and are still PCR positive in the nose. So you can get the virus again. The PCR test in the nose has about a 30% false negative rate. So there are patients who clearly have coronavirus, and it doesn't matter what the tests say. If they lost their sense of smell and taste, they've got coronavirus. And even if the test is negative, they still have to isolate themselves. And in fact, one of the questions that I didn't answer there was when we have a patient who has symptoms of a cold, a sore throat or a cough or a running nose, we actually tell them to go home and we assume that they have had coronavirus, because even if the test comes out negative, there's a 30% false negative rate and we do not want them around our patients. There is a second part to that question?
I think that's the question, but there is another question about what is the role of cyclosporin in psoriasis patients? Shall patients positive with COVID-19 to continue cyclosporin, or should be, the management plan should be different?
Yeah, so what all of the medical and patient organizations are recommending is that immunosuppressive therapies like cyclosporin be discontinued. I did show you several patients, which were mostly animal studies and in vitro studies, which showed that cyclosporin has a good impact on coronaviruses. It has an anti-coronavirus effect. In addition, I showed you the transplant article that's going to be published any day from Verona, showing that transplant patients did very well. So, you know, theoretically, we would not have to continue cyclosporin, but right now we don't know that answer. And the guideline from patient organizations is immunosuppressive therapy should be discontinued.
Yeah, there's a question about the role of dapsone and doxycycline in COVID-19. Do they have a role in the treatment of COVID-19?
I'm not aware of any studies that looked at their effectiveness in COVID-19, doxycycline or dapsone.
Another question about what could be the mechanisms of the new skin signs of COVID-19?
So we're pretty sure that it's related to the coagulation abnormality that these patients have. And when you look at various organs, including skin biopsies, and this is from an expert pathologist in Italy, they have microthrombi. And we think that it's a reduction in circulation because of those microthrombi. That's probably why that patient treated with enoxaparin and nitroglycerin paste got better.
There is a question about a relationship between the loss of smell and COVID-19. Is there any explanation for this?
You know, I'm going to be guessing here. Again, I would assume that it's a thrombotic event that hit whatever receptors or nerve is responsible for taste and smell, but I'm guessing. I don't know the answer.
We have a question about a new patient who is in need for biologic treatment, a psoriasis patient. What could be the approach here and with this pandemic of the COVID-19?
So it depends on how bad the patient is and what condition they have. If they are completely debilitated, that probably is more immunosuppressive than any drug we have. In fact, this conversation comes up with atopic dermatitis patients, for example. Dupilumab is there's no evidence that it is immunosuppressive. If you biopsy the skin and measure IL-4 levels in atopic dermatitis patients, they're sky high. If you give them dupilumab, they don't go down to zero, they go down to normal levels. So we're not making those patients immunosuppressed, we're making them normal. And I mentioned also the tie with dupilumab and asthma. So imagine a patient with horrific atopic dermatitis. That is debilitating and frankly makes them susceptible to everything, to bad outcomes with everything. And so normalizing those patients, I think, is heroic. I think you should be doing that. As for psoriasis, again, it depends how bad it is. If it is really awful, then those patients are sick and you need to actually treat them. If it is not, you have the option of, I showed you the data, I think the 17 and 23 blockers are safe. You could use those and probably not harm them at all. Although we don't know that for sure yet, that's probably going to end up being the case. And I did show you the data from Verona. Patients on biologics are not more prone to bad outcomes.
Question about phototherapy during COVID-19 for psoriasis patients. What could be the cheer?
I have a number of companies calling me, and I almost think it's silly because they think that phototherapy is going to cure coronavirus, and in fact ultraviolet light kills the coronavirus, but it doesn't kill the coronavirus in your lungs or in your brain or in your kidneys. It kills the coronavirus on your skin. So I don't think that ultraviolet light therapy is a cure. And of course, as long as you do social distancing and you prevent interactions, we have a few patients who we have continued on phototherapy. The issue for those patients is social distancing. Every patient who leaves our phototherapy unit, we disinfect the box afterward. We wipe down all the bulbs on the floor afterward. So we're down to only a few visits a week from hundreds of visits a week before.
The question about alopecia areata patients on JAK inhibitor, do you recommend to continue or discontinue this therapy?
So what I've done is the same thing that we do for the biologics. Basically, there is some evidence that baricitinib might actually be helpful in COVID-19 infection. That's the only one I know any data on. If patients are not infected, we continue them on the drug, but we tell them to self-isolate dramatically because we assume that they are more at risk than other patients. We don't know that, but we assume it. We don't necessarily stop their JAK inhibitor. One thing you know happens, if you stop JAK inhibitors in patients with alopecia areata, their hair falls out again.
There's a question here. Why some patients who was positive to COVID-19 and treated became negative, and after exposure to other positive patients become negative again? Is there mutation in the virus that more become worse and harmful to people?
So repeat that question from the start again. I didn't quite understand it.
Yeah, why some patients who are positive to COVID-19 and treated, they become negative. And after exposure to other positive patients, they became positive again.
Right, that's correct.
So they're asking about the explanation for this. Is it related to the mutation?
I don't know that we can attribute that to a mutation. I hope that's not the answer, because we're hoping that there will be a vaccine. Although we do know that there are mutations in the COVID-19 virus. I think the question is, are the antibodies that patient probably had, even if they tested negative, are those antibodies protective? And we know for sure that the natural antibodies that we get, and I'm not talking about a vaccine, the natural antibodies are probably helpful, but they are not fully protective, because I have patients who are antibody positive and still have PCR positive cultures when taken from their nasopharynx.
So Mark, if you could please close the, I'll stop sharing of your slides so they, I mean, the audience can see you more clearly.
Okay. If you can do that for me, let's see.
Okay, I'll try. Wait, I think you should do it from your screen. Yeah, great.
Okay, is that good?
Excellent. That's okay. Excellent. So people that are talking about, again, the hydroxychloroquine, there is a new study being evaluated and showing that maybe hydroxychloroquine is not effective in treating COVID-19. But there was some criticism on that paper being on very ill patients and terminal cases. So that's why maybe the failure of the treatments. So what is your take on such, a scenario of people saying it's like effective, others for the treatment being ineffective?
I don't know the answer to it. There's a lot of bad science out there. I think when the first data was reported from China, and I'm not even sure it was published, but it was reported at meetings from China, the data was very good. And that's why the French did those open label studies. And their data was very good for hydroxychloroquine. And then, you know, our president spoke about it and everybody made fun of him. And there's a lot of reason to make fun of him, but you know, you don't want that to affect your treatment. And I don't know the answer, but suddenly, you know, you have the New England Journal of Medicine publishing an article they should never have published. You know, you have, you know, and it's the best journal in the world. I mean, you know, phenomenal journal. And they published that, you know, article about hydroxychloroquine. At least I'm told they published it. I got an advanced copy of this article that I thought was a very poorly done study. So I think we don't know the answer. You know, Anthony Fauci, who's been the spokesperson for the NIH and CDC here in the United States, has said, you know, the trials weren't well done, so we don't have an answer. And I think that that's probably the only accurate thing we can say. We don't know if it works, we don't know if it makes it worse.
There's a question about younger people with skin signs. They have like symptoms and signs at the acral areas. So why young population, they have such presentation? It's like a good, it's a reflection of a good immunity or something else?
No, they actually, if they get the COVID toes and fingers, which we have seen in young patients a lot, actually, many, I have many photos of it. To me, that's almost a good sign because it shows that we're getting small microthrombi only affecting those areas and the big organs are unaffected. On the other hand, I showed you that shin in a very ill patient who had a large vessel, large thrombus, and that patient was badly affected. So the microthrombi, I think, are not dangerous, but clearly COVID-19 causes a coagulation abnormality that causes clots to form, even in young people.
There's a question about the role of spironolactone in treating COVID-19 disease. Do you have any comment on that?
This is the same story as hydroxychloroquine. When this started, spironolactone is known to increase that ACE2, which is an enzyme involved in coronavirus entering tissues. And because it increased that enzyme, people thought, it's going to make patients worse. Now the articles are saying maybe it's protective against coronavirus infection. So I don't know the answer. I showed you the article which raised the question that it might be protective.
There's a question about, there is any relation between the race and the severity of the illness? Arabians are less affected than European or blacks, versus whites. So yeah. Do you have?
So there's several lines of data that suggest differences. So I'm going to say, first of all, in New York City, a lot of the frontline healthcare workers, nurses, people who sit at our front desks, secretaries are Black or Hispanic, so they are really exposed more than others. First of all, there are certainly parts of the city where healthcare delivery is not as good, and they are overwhelmingly Black and Hispanic. And so they're, you know, people are pointing to that as a factor, which it might be. I will say that, that certainly at the hospital that I work in, prides itself on being equal opportunity for everybody. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor or Black or white or yellow, that everybody gets the same care. The third factor to consider, there's socioeconomic factors. So if the people who are likely to have gone to their summer homes, which are far away from New York City, are much more likely to be white, and that's a socioeconomic factor. They are more likely to have summer homes. They are on average wealthier, and there is a lack of equality there. And the last factor, which may play a role, is it has been said that androgen receptors play a role in the ability of coronavirus to penetrate the lungs and the body. At least one source claims that androgen receptors are increased in Black individuals compared to Caucasian individuals, and that all of those may all play a role. So I don't know that it has been looked at in Middle Eastern people. So I don't know if Arabs have more of that or less of that than others, but that's what has been claimed in African Americans.
There's a question about any mucosal changes or manifestations associated with COVID-19. And I think,
I'm trying to think if we have known of any. Patients do get pharyngitis and they get a sore throat, but I don't remember if we've seen anything on the oral mucosa.
I think we are up with questions here. And at the end of this session, I'd like to greatly thank our special guest speaker, Professor Mark DePauw, for his time and also for sharing his great experience, especially with this pandemic, which is information is needed from all over the world. So thank you for your information. Thank you for your knowledge and also practice, and share it with us. And in the same time, we'd like to also to thank all the attendees here. We have more than 700 attendees from 28 countries. So we hope we have added something to help the whole world with this pandemic. Again, thank you so much. And on behalf of the Saudi Society of Dermatology and Dermatologic Surgery, we'd like to see you again. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you very much. Delighted. I wish I was there in person, but delighted to participate.
Okay, invite you. Thank you so much.
All right. Bye-bye now.